Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to thank you for coming out today on a Saturday. I know it isn't always easy on a weekend to come out and do something like this, but the subject, you know, what is marijuana? What is cannabis? Here at the public library, which is really an amazing thing. But this is where all information is gathered and where people can come to find out. So this is a good time to have it here at this level. We're at the Malcolm X Library here in Canton. My name is Reginald Wyatt, and I live by cannabis. It means that I smoke marijuana, usually every day. I was diagnosed with an advanced state of prostate cancer back 19 years ago, and it was through normal medical treatment and cannabis that I'm here today to give you this lecture. But before I begin, I have to give you a disclaimer that's required by law to let you know that I'm not a lawyer, not a doctor, I'm not someone here to convince you to do one thing or the other. Just share the information that I know and how you can probably take advantage of it should you care to. I'm also going to tell you that the library is not responsible for the things that I say or in any way promote it or disavow it in any way. Just an open discussion that we have. But the fact that we can have it here in the library is really quite the deal because I think it's a perfect place to begin. I started to learn information about the library or discover what made it so special when I was just a little kid. And my first field trip out from school was to the library. When you went inside, up on above the shelves, it said adventure. And a little kid raised his hand and said, "What is that?" And the teacher stood up and said, "Well, that's a discovery of new experiences. It's what lies around the next corner. It's that mystery that we all get into when we travel along roads that we haven't traveled before." So when this diagnosis came up, I was on an adventure already. My wife and I and my partner here, Patricia, we had started a business and were working at that. And during the landscape project, the word came back to me that my diagnosis had come true and I needed to now do something about it. So my experience prior to this time was one involved where I did a lot of research for the Navy. I did 21 years, 3 months, and 4 days for the Navy. My background was computers, one of which you're required to know quite a bit. So I studied a lot. I involved myself a bit. And I was able to advance quite quickly and through in a rate that was quite difficult. So I knew how to research. So when I found myself on this adventure as to what to do about my prostate cancer, I went online. I went to hydroponic stores. I discovered that people were now smoking medical marijuana. And I didn't know what that was. I didn't know what weed was, what pot was, and grass, and reefer. But what was this medical marijuana thing that people were talking about? And then when we moved from where we were to another place, my landlord happened to be someone who had a medical marijuana card. And he asked me if I smoked. I said, "I don't smoke." He said, "No, I'm not talking about cigarettes." I said, "What do you mean?" He reached in his pocket and he pulled out what was then to be known as a joint. I said, "What the heck is that?" He said, "This is what I can now smoke legally." I said, "There's no way anybody can smoke marijuana legally." He said, "Yes, today," that was back in 1998, I think, "you can get a medical marijuana card with a recommendation from a doctor, and you can go to a dispensary, and you can find marijuana." Well, I didn't believe this, but I certainly wanted one of those cards. So, nervous as I was, because there was, in Hillcrest, is where we lived at the time, there was a dispensary just a block away. And you mentioned about how people are in the community not talking about these things. Well, the reason I'm here is to allow us to develop more conversation about this, just like you mentioned. Because I was so paranoid and so nervous about even a camera up on the road seeing me look to the left at the dispensary that I would always make sure I was looking the other direction. That's how nervous I was about being near marijuana. But all that passed because I really needed to do something about what was going on with my body. The doctor didn't give me a good prognosis, but said I had a good 5 years. That was 19 years ago. So I went online, did my research, talked to bud tenders. I got my medical marijuana card, and I found myself at a dispensary and talking to a bud tender. A bud tender is someone dispensary, and they're supposed to have all the knowledge as to what all the different strains were. But none of the jars I saw at the counter, and there were probably 50 of them, said pot, or reef, or grass, or the kind, a buffalo, and all the things that I knew what marijuana was called. It had things that they were like silver haze, green crack, northern lights, purple earth, you know, and all sorts of weird names. And I could not understand for the life of me how any of this could be medicinal. In fact, what was medicinal marijuana as opposed to regular weed? So the book kind of explained to me that when you grow it, as we do for the dispensary, it has to be clean. That means somebody has grown it and gotten rid of all the chemicals that might be there, gotten rid of any mold, no pesticides, no, that sort of thing. And that was supposed to be considered medical marijuana. Well, the idea was that, not that it was different than any other weed, pot, grass that we smoke, but that people in the use of it were discovering that it did some healing things for them. Some people had a better appetite. Some people could sleep better. Sometimes it increased your libido. Sometimes it makes you excited. You want to dance and party, or just sit around and eat a bowl of potato chips and watch, you know, a video on Netflix. But in any case, there were different types of marijuana. And based upon what your ailment was, it would depend upon what the attendant would recommend. So, in actuality, there was four categories. The category one being sativas. Sativa marijuana are those that affect your head, your brain, you know, your nerves. Whether you were, if you were depressed, you would smoke sativa and you would be uplifted. You would laugh, you feel joy, happiness. That's what it's like. For the body, they had indica. And indica works for pain, for any of the muscle aches and joint problems you might have, for your digestive system. Because our body has a system, it's called the endocrine, E-N-D-O-C-R-I-N-E. And that system is designed to have receptors that, when stimulated, will release hormones to different organs throughout your body. Well, the endocrine system has receptors that are looking for THC, looking for cannabis. And people don't realize that their body is waiting for this stuff to come in. I mean, marijuana has been used for thousands and thousands of years by all different kinds of cultures for its medicinal purposes. Well, one of my following lectures will be why that is not carried out here right now. Why have we had to go through this prohibition period and people giving you bad names as it moves on in today's society? But that's another lecture. The thing is that marijuana is not new. It's just our use here in the United States for a medical treatment that has made it what it is today. But then there are plants, marijuana plants, that are combined, sativa mixed with indica, and you have what is called a hybrid. A hybrid has some of the characteristics from a sativa, some of the characteristics from indica, and together they will do, you know, it's like mixing chocolate milk and white milk, you know, you get a blend. So those then affect the body, well, the body and the mind, or the head. Then there's something called root rubs. Now, root and rubs is simply a marijuana plant. Let me back up a second. Let me go back to sativas, just so you identify. If you were looking at a sativa plant, it would be one with thin leaves, it would be very tall and skinny, with long spaces between the internodes. They can grow 15 feet high in the outside spaces. The indica plant is going to grow short and squat, and have big wide leaves, like a great big hand. And it has great big thick buds, about that big, whereas a sativa plant has small buds on it. Bud being the flower that the female plant produces. Marijuana is only affected by female plants. The male plants, other than initially giving us the seeds, are something you do not want. Because you really want to grow marijuana without seeds. It's called sesamilia. Now, train of thought. Medical marijuana has also been expanded because people have found out about the medical side of marijuana that affects the people. It's called CBD, cannabidiol. And it is the primary medical product that comes out from the hemp didn't come back. But that's another lecture. I don't want to go there yet. So let me find out where I am. So what happened was that the marijuana that we have today at the dispensaries, when I first went to the dispensary, all the marijuana was open and out and simply in great big jars like that. You had your medical marijuana card, you could show it to the person, they checked you in, they showed you 21 years of age, that your description matched, and then you could go inside the vault where all this was displayed. You could smell it, you could taste it, I mean you could smell it and you could see it. He would explain to you what it is, and you could decide to choose which of those strains that you want. A strain is simply a type of marijuana. If we had sativa, for example, and you went into a dispensary and asked, well, what would it like to have? They would show you all the sativas across the top shelf. Sativas would be all those, once again, would affect your head. Then there's another shelf that affects your body. And then once again, there's a hybrid shelf, which combines the two. So you were going to have all the sativa strains. And there, when I looked up this morning for sativa, there were 1,376 strains of just sativa. But when I became aware of it at first, it was simply called weed. You couldn't tell if you got a sativa or indica. You got whatever the man passed you in the bag, and you threw your pocket and you went up. That's how it was done in the street. So sometimes you were up. Sometimes you were down, and sometimes it was just a bunch of seeds and stem, but it didn't do anything. The dispensaries eliminated all that, because they said we're going to make sure that you get a quality product. And so the price was up. They did clean it. They were beautifully manicured. You cut up all the leaves and leave just the flower, or what we call the bud. And the bud is actually, if you see a plant that people grow, any kind of plant there is, you have the male plant and the female. The females have pistils. When they get ready to flower, it's a little bit of white flower that comes up, and the pollen of the bee comes over, lands on the male plant, picks up the pollen, and carries it to the female plant. That same thing happens with marijuana, except male plants are bad news in a marijuana crop, because if the seeds release the pollen, and they fly over and land on a female plant, the effectiveness of that plant is reduced to about a third of what it used to be. So back in the old days, what I thought marijuana always came with seeds. That's supposed to be part of it, along with some stems, some leaves, things like that. But no, this marijuana that you bought in the dispensary had no seeds, no stems, no leaves, just bud. But the bud is a swollen, trichomes, T-R-T, maybe if I'm wrong, T-R-I-C-H-O-M-E-S, trichomes. They are little mushroom-shaped crystals that are actually on the leaf and form together in a bunch, and they form the psychoactive effect of marijuana. Well, when you have a bud, all you have is that great big, you have a bunch of those trichomes all together. That is what is effective for the marijuana. Now I have some photos I'm going to show you in a few minutes of plants, just in case you have not seen marijuana growing in a grow or see it up close and know what the trichomes are. And you'll see what I'm talking about. But when the plant is growing, both the buds and part of the leaves have all these trichomes all over it. So when I was first exposed to marijuana back in California, but I get a lot of time in Hawaii. When I first was exposed to it here back in the 70s, you then got a four-finger lid. It was just leaves, and there were no buds. There was no. I didn't discover buds until I got to Hawaii, and I found out that it was an entirely different plant entirely. Something called Maui Maui, and wow, it was. So we know what the meaning of sativa is, what indica is. Medical marijuana is now something that is special today, because for the first time in history, the Drug Enforcement Agency, the FDA, have removed marijuana from what is called a Schedule 1 list. The FDA keeps a list of all dangerous products, Schedule 1 being the worst. So not to 2 months ago, the DEA released Schedule 1, that marijuana, that CBD from that list, which means hemp farmers can begin growing again. And you will see a surge of CBD products. You can go to any drugstore now and just about find CBD offered as topicals that you can rub on. And the effects of the THC and or the CBD will cure aches and pains just by rubbing it on yourself. You can put it into foods and be able to eat it, drink it, and have the same effect. It takes longer to take effect, but it lasts longer and is more effective for you. You can smoke it in joints, or in vapes, or in bongs, or bowls, or pipes. But the vaporizer, one of which is better for your lungs, takes the marijuana plant, takes the marijuana amount of marijuana that you would roll in a joint, or put into a pipe, same amount, and give you 26% more effectiveness, because vape doesn't burn the marijuana. It simply heats it up to release the trichomes. And it leaves behind a non-burnt out residue of marijuana. You can use that to bake cookies, you can use that to make breads and things like that, and get the other benefits that